doctor is here. The question is, what are the common cardiac complications observed? This is not the first question. This is not the first question. Pregnancy. And what are the challenges? Does PCOD and diabetes are of two sides of the same coin? What special care which such patients require? First question to Dr. Vilas Bohe.
Thank you, sir. Gynec to start with, but unfortunately there is no gynecologist in the hall, in audience. So, anyway, the question is, what are the metabolic disorders in pregnancy? There are many metabolic disorders. The most common are gestational diabetes, then maternal obesity. Preeclampsia is also can be considered as metabolic disorders, but the etiopathogenesis is not a metabolic one. Then in neonates, when there is fetal distress before delivery, we know that there is lactic acidosis, though that's why that can be also considered as metabolic disorder. Then neonatal hypoglycemia is there, neonatal hyperbilirubinemia is there. And the most important, what we want to discuss here is polycystic ovarian disease. You know, polycystic ovarian disease is increasing day by day. It is related to infertility. Though PCOD is seen only in 10% of female population, but in infertility clinic, we see almost 30 to 40% patient, they are suffering with PCOD. So the basic etiology in polycystic ovarian disease is insulin resistance. When we were doing post-graduation in 1998, 1999, 2000, there was no definitive etiology known about PCOD. But now we know the definitive etiology is insulin resistance, and it is very common in India, in Asian countries. We know we suffer a lot because of type 2 diabetes mellitus, that because of insulin resistance. So PCOD patients, when becomes pregnant, their gestational diabetes is more common in these patients. Apart from these, there are many congenital anomalies we face in neonates because of all these metabolic disorders. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Vilas. Second question I'm putting to Dr. Gothwal, Nitin. What are the common gastrointestinal complications observed in patients of diabetes, and what are the challenges?
Diabetes affects most of the GI system, and most of them are motor disorders of the, or the motility disorders of the GI system. Starting from the upper end, the esophagus, the esophageal motility, the gastric emptying or the gastric motility, the colonic motility. So all of these, when they are affected, and you have a decrease in motility of all these intestinal organs, the GI system, pertaining to all the organs, if it is involving the esophagus, you have difficulty in swallowing, you have difficulty or symptoms associated with GERD, where there is delayed emptying, you have gastroparesis, where there is decrease in the motility of the colon, you have constipation, you have malabsorption syndrome. So all of these are common. And to treat with these complications and the associated diseases, basically control of glycemia and the lifestyle management and diabetes control is very important. And taking care of the nutritional habits of the patient is also very important. So medication as well as lifestyle modification is what we suggest.
Can you tell something about the management of diabetic gastroparesis, Nitin? And how does it differ from non-diabetic gastroparesis?
Gastroparesis per se is more common in diabetics, and to treat and to control, the best molecule is metoclopramide. The other molecules also are helpful, namely domperidone, sizapride, levosulfuride. But metoclopramide serves the best in control or in management of gastroparesis. As I previously just mentioned, lifestyle modification and making the patient more active, and control of glycemia. Hyperglycemia also causes gastroparesis. So once we have a good glycemic control, the outcome with the medications also is better.
Yes. Prolonged hypoglycemia. Hyperglycemia is one of the causes of gastroparesis. And usually, gastroparesis would be controlled by proper control of diabetes. It is due to affection of vagus. No. Next question I am putting to Dr. Pratap Jadhav. Where does a diabetologist need medical reference to an orthopedician? What all musculoskeletal disorders like osteoarthritis, OPA, common in diabetic patients? What special care they require?
In the diabetes patients, usually what you get is an osteoporosis, which is a significant factor associated with diabetes. Osteoarthritis may be exacerbated because in the initial phase when you put them, when they are devoid of the insulin, the osteoporosis is also exacerbated, and along with that, basically the cause of the pain is the peripheral neuropathies which are always there. So the pain is always exacerbated. So along with the calcium supplements and all those calcium analogs which are being given, you have to give a special consideration towards for the pain relief for the peripheral neuropathy. You have to give them methylcobalamin as well as the pregabalin preparations along with that to take care of the peripheral neuropathy. If along with the calcium supplements and some analgesics and the things which take care of the peripheral neuropathy, if you supplement all these things, the pain is very much lessened to a higher degree along with the control of diabetes, which is a must.
Yeah. The next question to Dr. Chetan. What are the challenges in management of asthma in a pregnant lady who is on antihypertensive medication?
Basically, here we are dealing with the three drugs, that is glucocorticosteroids that are used in COPD patients or asthma patients that can lead to increase in blood pressure in these PH patients. Also, when in this PH patient, labetalol or other beta blockers are used, asthma can be exacerbated, and for them we use generally terbutaline or salbutamol or metoprolol. And also when we use NSAIDs for this patient, especially aspirin for PH patient, also aspirin induced asthma is very common. That is why we have to deal with them accordingly.
Yeah. Dr. Pratap, in IBD patients, it has been shown that in up to 30% of cases, bones and joints are involved. How frequently and how severely it is seen in clinics? What steps are taken to fulfill the nutrition deficit seen in IBD?
IBD means inflammatory bowel disease. Usually when you get these patients of inflammatory bowel disease, all the metabolism as far as the patient is concerned is disturbed. So when you get them, basically you have to take care of the inflammatory bowel first, and you have to prescribe the analgesics which has been given, which are all gastro-friendly. Along with that, in these patients, you usually get a sort of arthritis which is transient, but then this arthritis is not permanent. Along with the exacerbation, they may have bony pains, muscle fatigues, aches, and everything. So nutrition-wise, I will say that you have to prescribe with this L-carnitine and other things which take care of the muscles, as well as along with that, the calcium supplements may not be given. Only analgesics have a major role along with this patient which are on such a drug. Inflammatory bowel disease should not get exacerbated. So mouth dissolving analgesics are usually prescribed.
Yeah. Dr. Chetan, what complications can we expect in patients of asthma, COPD and any other lung disease on NSAID?
Complications associated with NSAIDs, basically I already told that some asthmatic patients get exacerbated with aspirin and other NSAIDs. Also, there are some variety of COPD patients that are also exacerbated by these NSAIDs.
Yeah. Dr. Gothwal, it has been seen many times that GERD patients have cardiac complications. So what are the common cardiac complications seen in patients with GERD, and what special care these patients require?
So the symptoms mimicking GERD and chest pain are overlying, and they both present with common symptomatology. Basically, it is a high index of suspicion which a gastroenterologist and a surgeon has to go about with. Wherever you are having a patient with chest pain, whether to differentiate it with because of GERD or because of myocardial infarction, the reflux of acid into the esophagus stimulates the pain. The esophageal pain can many a times mimic cardiac pain. So if there is any doubt about the chest pain being of cardiac origin, it is always better to have an opinion of the cardiologist or a chest or a physician to opine upon. And since both are common symptoms, treating GERD should be a secondary management, because that is not life-threatening. Cardiac complaints, cardiac symptoms can be more life-threatening. So managing the cardiac part first would be the priority, and then looking into the GERD symptoms.
Minas, what are the patients of PCOD? Shall we refer them to an endocrinologist or a gynecologist?
Being a gynecologist, I will always say that PCOD is a subject of gynecologist only. But in advanced cases, when there is severe PCOD with its metabolic with severe metabolic syndrome and complications, we can refer the patient to endocrinologist for sure.
When a lot of androgen effect is there, at that time probably
severe hypoandrogenism causing hirsutism, weight gain, obesity, then we can refer the patient to endocrinologist.
Yes, I have a long question for Dr. Pratap Jadhav. I would like to split it into 2-3. What are the steps in management of osteoporosis? Calcium and vitamin D3, is it prescribed with all other treatment options? Which is the best calcium salt with less side effect? Which is preferred, daily vitamin D or monthly or simultaneous administration? Which biophosphonate is preferred?
As far as the management of osteoporosis is concerned, the osteoporosis can be age-related, can be postmenopausal. These are the usual things which we get. Or then the lifestyle changes. Because of the sedentary lifestyle also, there is a lot of osteoporosis. You have to change the lifestyle. Should have plenty of oral intake in the form of, I think, milk products, green leafy vegetables. And along with that, if calcium is to be supplemented, that is to be given the calcium carbonates and calcium citrate malleate. They have the highest bioavailability. So along with that, if you give vitamin D3 supplements, the vitamin D3, which is hydroxycholic calcium, that facilitates the absorption of calcium. So prescribing a vitamin D3 is not a contraindication. So always you may not, but if D3 is not exposed to sunlight, is having a sedentary lifestyle, then vitamin D3 can be supplemented. Now, initially we used to give 6 lakh units, which were given for 6 months. But newer formulations are always coming up. Now we have got daily administration as well as weekly administration that do not hamper the bioavailability of the drug. And when we come to the biophosphonates means two phosphonates are there. This is available as an oral preparation as well as an intravenous preparation. The most commonly available biphosphonates which we have, they have nitrogen base in that, and they act, biphosphonates basically act by apoptosis of the osteoclastic cells, and the FSSP enzyme which is present on that, they act, and there is phenylation of the proteins. So wherever you get the situation of hypercalcemia, that means in metastatic disorders, Paget's disease, osteitis grex, osteitis deformans, or some metastatic disorders, some initial carcinomatous stages, biphosphonates are very much useful. But then biphosphonates have their own complications. When you prescribe these oral biphosphonates, which are available as alendronate, ibudronate, then minudronate, there is a lot of things. The patient should not have any esophageal disorder. And if there is no esophageal disorder, still for the drugs to go down, because it causes lot of esophagitis and inflammation, then you have to specifically tell the patient that he has to sit upright after taking these drugs. Yeah. And when we come to the drugs like zoledronic acid, which are given once in a year, it is an IV dose. When we give that IV dose, the patient may develop series of complications because of the working of some enzyme, and patient can have flu-like symptoms, meningitis-like symptoms, which have to be tackled. And along with that, most important is that he should not have dental caries or some dental procedure carried on, because most common complications seen with this intravenous zoledronic acid is the osteonecrosis of jaw.
Thank you. Now Nitin, what are the some patients' complaints of adverse effect with calcium supplements? How to address that? And addressing the issue of reflux esophagitis associated with biphosphonates, how do you do that?
Sir, as Dr. Jadhav has already addressed to the question, biphosphonates, the oral preparations causing esophagitis. So as he has said, we're sitting in the upright position, avoiding oral preparations of biphosphonates or using an IV medication, and also ruling out whether the patient has a pre-existing GERD before you have prescribed a patient with biphosphonate are one of the few basic precautions that we have to take. As far as the complications that patients come with calcium, the most common that we come across is constipation associated with that. So either reducing the dose or increasing the fiber content of the diet, increasing the water intake in the daily dosage of your water intake. These are the simplest forms that we can address to overcome the constipation associated with calcium intake. Per se, calcium is not a troublesome drug, but biphosphonates, yes. And he has already answered the question before I could address to that.
Yes. There is a very common problem. PPIs can affect the absorption of calcium, vitamin B12 and other nutrients, which on the long term can be a risk factor for further things. Which PPI can affect them and what should we do?
I did not get the question.
PPIs can affect the absorption of calcium, vitamin B12 and other nutrients.
Mm-hmm.
Any precautions?
So we would not ask the patient to take the calcium supplements or vitamin supplements in combination or at the same time as you are taking a PPI. So we would switch the time, or say if the patient is on twice a day dosage, then we would at least put the patient on a sustained release formulation of PPI, which he takes in the morning empty stomach, and then we can ask the patient to take these calciums and vitamin supplements separately, maybe at bedtime or other time of the day.
Okay. Dr. Vilas, there are cases of IBD, young females who want to conceive. How are the cases of IBD are managed to young females who want to conceive? How the treatment differ in cases of active disease and those in remission? I want Dr. Nitin and Vilas to answer the question.
As such, IBD, inflammatory bowel diseases, and pregnancy, these are the very rare combinations. But if inflammatory bowel disease is because of any autoimmune conditions, or then we can face such patients of systemic lupus erythematosus. There are dreaded complications during pregnancy like preeclampsia, eclampsia, bad obstetric history, recurrent abortions, intrauterine deaths. So, proper investigations for inflammatory bowel disease before planning pregnancy is very important. We should rule out all autoimmune conditions in which we see inflammatory bowel diseases.
Yeah.
Basically, patients with IBD who are put on immunomodulators are the person who have to be cautioned about planning a pregnancy. And immunomodulators like methotrexate, sulfasalazine, these are the drugs which have to be withheld prior to the planning of pregnancy, at least 4 to 6 months prior. Also, if males are suffering from IBD and are put on immunomodulators, the oligospermia can also be one of the problems that which, they can face, and they may land up with infertility. So patients have to be informed if they are on immunomodulators and if they are planning pregnancy to withhold these drugs, and about the possibilities of the infertility and less chances of conceiving to be informed to them.
Okay. Can NSAIDs be prescribed for patients with GERD?
No, sir. Complete contraindication. NSAID is in a patient who is proven with GERD, no. The best formulations would be either simple paracetamol, tramadol, these are the combination, but no NSAIDs in patients with GERD.
Yeah.
GERD symptoms.
Vilas, what are the patients of PCOD? Shall we refer them to an endocrinologist or a gynecologist?
Being a gynecologist, I will always say that PCOD is a subject of gynecologist only. But in advanced cases, when there is severe PCOD with its metabolic with severe metabolic syndrome, and complications, we can refer the patient to endocrinologist for sure.
Well, a lot of androgen effect is there. At that time, probably
severe hypoandrogenism causing hirsutism, weight gain, obesity. Then we can refer the patient to endocrinologist.
Yes. I have a long question for Dr. Pratap Jadhav. I would like to split it into 2-3. What are the steps in management of osteoporosis? Calcium and vitamin D3, is it prescribed with all other treatment options? Which is the best calcium salt with less side effect? Which is preferred, daily vitamin D or monthly or simultaneous administration? Which biophosphonate is preferred?
As far as the management of osteoporosis is concerned, the osteoporosis can be age-related, can be postmenopausal. These are the usual things which we get. Or then the lifestyle changes. Because of the sedentary lifestyle also, there is a lot of osteoporosis. You have to change the lifestyle. Should have plenty of oral intake in the form of, I think, milk products, green leafy vegetables. And along with that, if calcium is to be supplemented, that is to be given the calcium carbonates and calcium citrate malleate. They have the highest bioavailability. So along with that, if you give vitamin D3 supplements, the vitamin D3, which is hydroxycholecalciferol, that facilitates the absorption of calcium. So prescribing a vitamin D3 is not a contraindication. So always you may not, but if you is not exposed to sunlight, is having a sedentary lifestyle, then vitamin D3 can be supplemented. Now, initially we used to give 6 lakh units which were given for 6 months. But newer formulations are always coming up. Now we have got daily administration as well as weekly administration. That do not hamper the bioavailability of the drug. And when we come to the biophosphonates means 2 phosphonates are there. This is available as an oral preparation as well as an intravenous preparation. The most commonly available biphosphonates which we have, they have nitrogen base in that, and they act, biphosphonates basically act by apoptosis of the osteoclastic cells, and the FSSP enzyme which is present, on that they act, and there is phenylation of the proteins. So wherever you get the situation of hypercalcemia, that means in metastatic disorders, Paget's disease, osteitis grex, osteitis deformans, or some metastatic disorders, some initial carcinomatous stages, biphosphonates are very much useful. But then biphosphonates have their own complications. When you prescribe these oral biphosphonates, which are available as alendronate, ibudronate, then minudronate, there is a lot of things. The patient should not have any esophageal disorder. And if there is no esophageal disorder, still for the drugs to go down, because it causes lot of esophagitis and inflammation. Then you have to specifically tell the patient that he has to sit upright after taking these drugs. Yeah. And when we come to the drugs like zoledronic acid, which are given once in a year, it is an IV dose. When we give that IV dose, the patient may develop series of complications because of the working of some enzyme, and patient can have flu-like symptoms, meningitis-like symptoms, which have to be tackled. And along with that, most important is that he should not have dental caries or some dental procedure carried on, because most common complications seen with this intravenous zoledronic acid is the osteonecrosis of jaw.
Thank you. Dr. Nitin, what are the some patients' complaints of adverse effect with calcium supplements? How to address them? And addressing the issue of reflux esophagitis associated with biphosphonates, how do you do that?
Sir, as Dr. Jadhav has already addressed to the question, biphosphonates, the oral preparations causing esophagitis. So as he has said, we're sitting in the upright position, avoiding oral preparations of biphosphonates or using an IV medication, and also ruling out whether the patient has a pre-existing GERD before you have prescribed a patient with biphosphonate are one of the few basic precautions that we have to take. As far as the complications that patients come with calcium, the most common that we come across is constipation associated with that. So either reducing the dose or increasing the fiber content of the diet, increasing the water intake in the daily dosage of your water intake. These are the simplest forms that we can address to overcome the constipation associated with calcium intake. Per se, calcium is not a troublesome drug, but biphosphonates, yes. And he has already answered the question before I could address to that.
Yes. This is a very common problem. PPIs can affect the absorption of calcium, vitamin B12 and other nutrients, which on the long term can be a risk factor for further things. Which PPI can affect them and what should we do?
I did not get the question.
PPIs can affect the absorption of calcium, vitamin B12 and other nutrients.
Mm-hmm.
Any precautions?
So we would not ask the patient to take the calcium supplements or vitamin supplements in combination or at the same time as you are taking a PPI. So we would switch the time, or say if the patient is on twice a day dosage, then we would at least put the patient on a sustained release formulation of PPI, which he takes in the morning empty stomach, and then we can ask the patient to take these calcium and vitamin supplements separately, maybe at bedtime or other time of the day.
Okay. Dr. Vilas, there are cases of IBD, young females who want to conceive. How are the cases of IBD are managed to young females who want to conceive? How the treatment differ in cases of active disease and those in remission? I want Dr. Nitin and Vilas to answer the question.
As such, IBD, inflammatory bowel diseases, and pregnancy, these are the very rare combinations. But if inflammatory bowel disease is because of any autoimmune conditions, then we can face such patients of systemic lupus erythematosus. There are dreaded complications during pregnancy like preeclampsia, eclampsia, bad obstetric history, recurrent abortions, intrauterine deaths. So proper investigations for inflammatory bowel disease before planning pregnancy is very important. We should rule out all autoimmune conditions in which we see inflammatory bowel diseases.
Yeah.
Basically, patients with IBD who are put on immunomodulators are the person who have to be cautioned about planning a pregnancy, and immunomodulators like methotrexate, sulfasalazine, these are the drugs which have to be withheld prior to the planning of pregnancy, at least 4 to 6 months prior. Also, if males who are suffering from IBD and are put on immunomodulators, the oligospermia can also be one of the problems that they can face, and they may land up with infertility. So patients have to be informed if they are on immunomodulators and if they are planning pregnancy to withhold these drugs, and about the possibilities of the infertility and less chances of conceiving to be informed to them.
Okay. Can NSAIDs be prescribed for patients with GERD?
No, sir. Complete contraindication. NSAID is in a patient who is proven with GERD, no. The best formulations would be either simple paracetamol, tramadol, these are the combinations, but no NSAIDs in patients with GERD.
Intra-articular steroid usually causes rise in the sugar level. So that may last for a longer period. So in that cases, intra-articular steroids in all the patients which are diabetic, as far as possible it should be avoided, because long-term deleterious effects of the steroid is always on the cartilage. So as far as possible you should avoid them, because they lead to the rise in the sugar level. At the same time, the long-term deleterious effects are always on the cartilage. So as far as possible, avoid intra-articular steroid in diabetic patients.
One more question, Dr. Chetan. Does the maternal use of acid suppressive medications in pregnancy associated with increased risk of asthma in the offspring?
What, sir?
Does the maternal use of acid suppressive medication in pregnancy is associated with the increased risk of asthma in the offspring?
Yes, sir. It has been proven in studies that maternal use of PPI basically increases the chances of asthma in infant, and also increases the chances of allergic conditions in infants.
Left for Dr. Milind. Let him come, he is coming. One more question to Dr. Vilas Boy. It has been seen many times pregnant patients have high blood pressure. So what special care to be taken in managing pregnancy-induced hypertension? And what are the challenges? Any special care when you take?
Audience is looking very tense and stressed out. Pregnancy-induced hypertension is one of my favorite topics, and I would like to make this environment a little bit light by telling few interesting things about pregnancy-induced hypertension. Pregnancy-induced hypertension, all of you know that 5% incidence is there, and it is very common in primigravidas, not in multigravidas. Why it is common in primigravidas, especially if the patient, if the wife conceives within 6 months of her marriage. The reason is, we know that after conception, the fetus in the uterus is nothing but a graft, because 50% antigens are from father and 50% from mother. So there are likely chances of graft versus host reaction and rejection of the fetus, and we can face recurrent abortions in few patients. 18-20 years back, there was no actual definitive etiology of pregnancy-induced hypertension was known. There were many theories, like calcium is less, calcium levels are less, many theories were there. But later on, the proper definitive etiology was found out, and it was improper decidualization of blood vessels of uterus. And because of that, there is increase in peripheral vascular resistance, and that's why after 20 weeks of gestation, there is rise in blood pressure of the pregnant lady. And that is, we call it as pregnancy-induced hypertension. The features of pregnancy-induced hypertension are hypertension, pitting edema, pathological edema, and proteinuria. And when it is associated with convulsions, we call it as eclampsia. Pregnancy-induced hypertension has definitely increased the mortality rate in pregnant lady and even a neonatal mortality. So what was the interesting thing? Why I asked the question that it is very common in primary gravidant, especially before when wife conceives within 6 months. Similarly, there is one question. If the lady changes her partner for next pregnancy, again there are chances of pregnancy-induced hypertension. Can you guess? What I told you, graft versus host reaction. If the wife conceives earlier, she is not familiar to antigens of her husband. If she conceives late, after 1 year of her marriage or 2 years of marriage, there are less chances of pregnancy-induced hypertension. That means there is one more study. If there is oral sex, regular oral sex, and the female is swallowing semen regularly, the chances of pregnancy-induced hypertension are less. Because she gets familiar to sperm antigens earlier, and that's why there is no graft versus host reaction.
You mean that they have to be sensitized for that? Yes, so sensitization is a must.
Jadhav sir is saying they must be sensitized for that. No, we are living in India, so that's why I am not giving such advice to my patients. Thank you, sir.
Dr. Nitin, last question. GERD is commonly seen in during pregnancy. The symptoms may aggravate with progression of pregnancy. How is it taken care of? Throw some light on the usage of PPI during pregnancy.
PPIs per se are safe medications in pregnancy, and we have been using them commonly. Before we put the patient on PPI for a longer duration of time, a trial period of a shorter duration and control of the symptoms, and once the symptoms have been controlled, asking the patient to take care of their meal timings, their going to bed after meals, the putting the bed in a slightly head high position where you can prevent the regurgitations from occurring, and taking regular walks and increasing the physical activity so that the gestating emptying is facilitated. These are the common methods that have to be taken care of to control GERD. But in case if the patient is not responding to all the other methods and the modifications that we have suggested, then the patient can be given a sustained release formulation. But no, I would not suggest using motility drugs in patients who are pregnant. A simple PPI would be sufficient enough, along with taking care of the meal timings, the size of the meal, the proportion of the meal, and the timing of the meal before they go to bed. So these are the common things that can be taken care of.
Thank you very much. I thank all the panelists for being very short and precise in their answers. And also I would request all the audience to keep the preparation, the questions prepared, and fire the questions to the panelists. We have 10 minutes for the same. If you have any question, you're welcome. Yes.
Metformin is basically the insulin sensitizer, and as I told that the basic etiopathogenesis in PCOD is insulin resistance. So metformin is very commonly used in the management of PCOD as an insulin sensitizer. So it's the function of the insulin is made better, so it works better in the body, and so the anovulation and hyperandrogenism is reduced. If the patient is infertile, commonly use metformin for the management of infertility also.
Do you use in all patients of PCOD metformin?
Pardon, sir?
Do you use metformin in all patients of PCOD you see?
Almost
it is a trial of metformin.
Almost I use metformin almost in all patients of PCOD. Even lean PCOD I use metformin. Lean PCOD means 30% of PCOD patients they are thin. What we see in PCOD in 70% patient we see obesity, but 30% patient they are lean PCOD patient. Still actually what I see the insulin resistance is more in lean PCOS patient. So there are very good results of metformin, and even we use myoinositol as an insulin sensitizer.
Have you come across hypoglycemia any time by metformin?
No, never. The most common side effects what I face with metformin is GI disturbances.
Yeah. Any other questions?
Sir, my question is to Dr. Pratap Jadhav, sir. Sir, in your speech you said, in case of osteoporosis, we have to go for long-term use of calcium. And you said calcium citrates and calcium the other calcium bicarbonates. If we go for long-term use for this calcium bicarbonates, it can cause saturation of that calcium, may lead to renal calculi and other diseases. And calcium citrates are excreted through the urine. So which one is best? Whether calcium citrate should be used or calcium carbonate should be used?
The bioavailability of calcium citrate malleate has been said to be more, but carbonates are also having a good bioavailability. And all the while, it has never been demonstrated that this calcium which we give orally, they are the cause of the renal calculi. There are so many factors which lead to the formation of the calculi. And taking the oral calcium is not a contraindication for even if the patient is having renal calculi, the calcium supplements which are given, they may not go to the kidneys and form the calculi. It is the biophysiology is totally different for the development of calculi. So long-term usage of the calcium supplements, which we get many a times more in diet, still they don't get. It's the tendency of formation with that particular. Whenever we are having calculi, if you study the structure of the calculi, they may be of the biochemistry may be different. So long-term usage of calcium citrate malleate or carbonate, they don't invariably cause the calculi.
Any other? Do the panelists want to ask the other panelists any question? If you have inter-panelist question, because they are all of different specialties, so they are, if they have a question, they can be go ahead and ask.
We can ask those questions during fellowship, sir.
Okay, it's okay, fine. We have been late.
I can see the faces, all of them.
Good.
And they are very, very well convinced with this IAMICON function.
Yeah.
Because basically, this panel discussion has been all, everybody knows everything.
Yeah, okay, it's been. Thank you, the audience for your active participation. I once again thank all the panelists for their nice questions and participation. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.